So I'm going to go ahead and get started so we can get done. It is a Friday afternoon. So as you all can see on this first chart, when I first started my business, it wasn't like you all do it today. We had to put together all of our policies and procedures, and we had to take them over to DHSR, sit down and let them flip through it and read what we had put together. So once you got your license, they told me, they said, when you get 7 clients, call us. So you're supposed to go through everything, get the clients, and then you were supposed to notify them. And they actually came and did an audit to see if you were on track. So they came and started looking at my information. And so that was a DHSR consultant. Those are the people that approve the policies. Those are the people that do the surveys. And so as she was looking through everything, she said, when you look at a client's chart, the documentation should read like a novel. And I thought that was interesting because really, when you assume that client, you're documenting everything that's happening with that client while they're under your care. And so I thought that was very interesting that she said that. So I wanted to just make you all aware of that. When you start looking at your client charts, if you see big chunks of information are missing, or this has been a really long time since there was documentation, either of course you're doing the supervisory visits every 90 days if you're in-home aid, or you're calling them or whatever you're doing if it is companion care, you're doing all of that, but it needs to be documented in some way. So that's what I'm going to talk about today, because sometimes you lose track of what your charts should really look like. And you really just need to make sure that you're keeping all of those things up to date. So the way that you're getting this information is when you actually admit a client, there's a lot of information that you're getting. So this is your start point. If you were writing a book or whatever, this is your starting point. You have your demographic information. That's where you have the name, address, their race, date of birth, their emergency contacts, their diagnosis, who their doctor is. You're getting all of that information. And just a point right here, in your client chart, there should never be a social security number. So if you have a client's social security number in your chart, you go and get those out right away. You can have some other type of number that you identify your clients by. And basically, I would identify mine by, say, if I admitted them today, 7822, I would go ahead and if I admitted them today, that would be their day, their number with an A behind it for admission. That's how I kept track of it. If I had more than one that day, they would be A1, A2. And you know, that's kind of rare, but it can happen. So that was the number that I assigned. And for those of you that are doing Medicaid, it asks you for a client ID number somewhere along the way when you're submitting your claims. And that's that's just something that you can have in your record. And then the physical assessment, you're going to assess everything about that client. You're going to look at their medications, how they move about the house, what type of equipment they use. Do they use a walker, wheelchair? You're going to look at everything physically that they need to get around the home and how they function. And then you're going to look at the home environment. That includes all of the furniture in the house, the doorways, the steps coming into the house, and also make sure that environment assessment, if they have dogs outside, make sure you make a note of that. I think I've told you all before that I had one client that had these like 4 or 5 huge dogs outside the house. They were tied up. But when I rolled up to that house, I wouldn't get out of the car. I'd blow the horn for them to come out and get me because I was like, I just know those dogs are going to break that rope or that chain, or the chain is long enough for them to get to me. So I always waited. That is very important for your aides going there and your nurses. They need to know that because you're responsible for their health. And then one thing that we do is we do an economic assessment. That is, you ask the client, are you able to afford your food? your medication? Are you having any trouble paying your utility bills? You do that assessment, and then you don't have to do pay it for them, but you need to find resources. We had clients where sometimes we found food banks where they could get extra food or whatever, but you do that assessment and you do something with it. And then on admission, you're going to do that initial care plan. Initially, you're going to go ahead and write that first care plan that they're supposed to have based on all the information that I just talked about. And that care plan is going to need to stay up to date. And we talked about that many times, but just so you all know that, you need to be sure that's a great part of it. There are other sources of information for you to put into the chart. I mentioned the supervisory visits. You're doing those supervisory visits every 90 days if you're an in-home aid service, or if you're companion care, you're doing them at a different time, or you're calling them. Make sure you document that. The way we had a supervisory visit form that we filled out for every client. And when we brought that back into the office, we put it in the chart, but we went to the nurse's notes or the chronological notes, and we put a note there that said supervisory visit was completed, so that we knew when we flipped to the supervisory visits, it should be there. And so that's still giving a record, a chronological record of what's going on with that client. So if someone came in and looked in that chart, they would see maybe that you admitted them in September, and then in December, someone went back to do a visit, if you know, if that's correct. And then they would look at the information on there. You don't have to rewrite that information once you put it on the supervisory visit form, but you would indicate that it's done and it's in order and that it's in place. I would always ask about the doctor's visits. Have you been to the doctor? And they may say, yes, I went to my primary, I went to the eye doctor. Make sure you know about their doctor's visits and if they've had medications that they don't take anymore. And just make a note of it as far as the nurses that are doing the visits, or if it's the service supervisor, just make sure you know that they're keeping their appointments and all of that. And of course, if there's anything that you find on those supervisory visits, then you need to address it as a nurse or as an agency. If you have someone in the office that takes care of it, if it's something that the doctor needs to know, you need to make sure that that happens. Or if you need to let the family member know, her ankles are swelling more than they should, what are you all eating? Do you need to let the doctor know? Is the medication correct? Our nurses know how to do that. And then sometimes you get phone calls about things going on in the home. The client, sometimes the client may call and they'll say, I'm going on vacation. I'll be away for a week. That's significant. I would write that in the chart. Anything like that, or they, if they call you and they've got a something maybe where they've had a caregiver and it's going to change, or they're going to get an additional caregiver, you want to make a note of those things. And also, if you have, say, one daughter on the demographic information when you admitted them and they call you and let you know that has changed, you want to update that and just make a note in the chart. But it should be a running log of what's going on with that client. And then your aides are telling you, hopefully your aides are advising you and telling you things all the time about what's going on with that client. Your aides should be under obligation, and you know it should be part of their task. If anything changes in that client's home, they need to be calling you, letting you know, or maybe they put it in their documentation. But someone needs to review those aides notes. A nurse needs to review those at least on a weekly basis. But the aides need to know if something significant happens. They don't wait until you look at the notes. They need to call and let you know, unless you have some other way for them to get that information to you. And it needs to be acted upon if that happens. So some of the other things that you want to document is if the physical health of that client changes, or if they have a change in cognition, if they start to have memory problems, you want to document those changes somewhere in the chart. we actually had a physical assessment form, which you fill out on admission, but you can always fill out another one. I wouldn't update that particular first one because it's been noted, documented by the nurse that it happened on that date, but just pull out another one and start over. And if you know those physical changes and cognitive changes have taken place, that may mean that that aide no longer can be with that client if they're not on the registry. So just keep that in mind. You need to be staying on top of that because if they had two ADLs that were extensive when you admitted them and now they've got three or four or something changed, you may need to give them a brand new aide. So this all this stuff is relevant. And then if a client moves, it would be logical that if your client moved from one apartment to the other or moved in with their kids, you need to go to that home and look at the home environment and fill out your home environment assessment again. You don't start a new chart. They're still your client. Your aide is going to go there, but you need to go there and look at that environment and update that information. And sometimes, maybe in the home, as I mentioned before, the caregiver may change. It may be someone new moving in or that situation changes. That's a home environment change. Something happened in that home. And then as far as economic, they may have financial challenges. Maybe they didn't update their something that Medicaid needed for them and they were getting a check or whatever and it has stopped. Or they've got significant bills for medications and they're having trouble. So your nurses need to ask about that when they go. Your aides see it too. Your aides see when there's not as much food in the house as there used to be, that, you know, things are not going well. They need to be reporting that to you. And then for sure, if you've had changes in physical health, cognitive health, that care plan is probably going to change. It is probably going to change. And this is whether it's a private client or whether it's a Medicaid client or whatever. Now, if you're doing a Medicaid client and there's a major change, you need to be letting the Medicaid people know, or you need to be letting Liberty know that changes have taken place. That's why they want you to go visit that client, because they want you to keep track of things. And if it's not time for them to visit, you're supposed to let them know. So basically, that's what I have put together for you all today. I hope you all will have questions around what I talked about. And as I always do, I try to make sure that I let you know that I'm happy to give you all this information, but don't make any changes to your practice until you go to the authority that you're under, your contractors, federal laws, state laws, and then you can make any changes based on that. But we hope that we can provide you exactly what you need so that you know who to ask. So we're at the point now where if you all have any questions about what I've covered or something that maybe I didn't bring up that you have a question about, feel free to open your mic and go ahead and speak.
Patty, do you use the same assessment form that you use for the initial assessment, for your reassessments?
Yes, you can definitely do that. And since you brought that up, Frank, you know that you admit that client, you are supposed to reassess every year. Even though you've been doing those supervisory visits, you're supposed to put a clean reassessment in there on a yearly basis. Just update everything. Like if the nurse was doing supervisory visits and say in 60 days, there was a major change with that client, that probably would serve to start the year there again. But if everything has just been ho-hum with that client all of this time and there hasn't been a reassessment done, you want to do that once a year. Just one more thing for you to keep track of.
Well, so there is a difference then between the supervisory visit and that annual reassessment?
Well, on the supervisory visits, you're checking certain things and making sure that everything is okay. But the reassessment would be you would go back and look at it holistically at the client.
Okay.
You know, just look at the reassessment, look at their physical condition and all of that. If everything has kind of been just going so-so, you want to document that you looked at everything in totality.
Right. Well, we might need to, I mean, that's kind of what we're doing every single time. So maybe we can streamline some of our supervisory visits, not to be extensive.
Yes. Because what I had is a one-page supervisory visit that doesn't go into all that. You're kind of looking at it as a nurse. You're looking at everything, but then you want to document that you looked at everything once a year. And those of you that are with Medicaid, I think that's one of your requirements, is that you do a reassessment. And of course, Liberty's going to do one too. They're going to do one once a year, but you know, we go back behind them and we do a physical assessment ourselves that is also required.
So Patty, if a patient gets, a client get an increase in hours because they have a functional decline, do we go back and do another assessment, a head-to-toe assessment?
You mean Liberty gave them more hours because their condition changed?
Yes. But they still need a PCA. They still limited assist, but they got more services.
I would think based on that, you could just document it on your supervisory visit.
Okay.
You know, you could probably just document it there.
So, go ahead.
Go ahead.
So we've been pretty much reassessing every 90 days, and then more often than not, everything stays pretty much the same. But we just had a client who, I mean, we changed a bunch of the tasks, and we went in, it's been like a week, we changed a bunch of the tasks. And so now I feel at that point we have the client re-sign the plan of care because it's changed so drastically, and we post that new version in their home. But really we've been doing that every 90 days anyway. So it sounds like maybe we don't need to be that thorough. I mean, we want to be thorough. I take that back, but you know what I mean? Like we're doing the whole thing every 90 days.
Yeah, you probably don't need to, but it's based on the client's condition. If they're changing that much, but if they're not changing that much, your supervisory visit should be sufficient, because you kind of look at their physical health. There's on the supervisory visit form that I follow, you're looking at all of that kind of at a high level. But of course, like I said, if things change that much, yeah, you want to really document it, change the plan of care and all of that. And that's based on the nurse's judgment. But I don't think doing a full reassessment every 90 days, if there's not a major change, I can't see the need for that. I never did that. I just documented it on my supervisory visit form. But if it was something major, of course, I did do a full assessment.
Okay. And then if somebody has something else to add to that, we can talk about that. I have something kind of off topic, so I don't know if there's anything to add to that.
Okay.
I have a question about the home environment. So if I have a client with the home environment and I'm doing an assessment, and let's say this client has like a lot of rodents and there's other issues, but because they live in a county, the county has no code enforcement as far as housing standards like the town does. So the landlord will not fix anything. So I'm running around trying to find resources in order to get things done for this client. Should I be documenting all of this?
Yes, I certainly would, because what if something happened later where one of the rodents bit the client and then they got a sore? And so you can document and show that you were trying to get that taken care of. Now, y'all, some of the stuff that I did, I kind of went outside the lines. When I saw something like that, I took care of it. I didn't have to, but I knew people that were yards people and exterminators, and sometimes I could not walk away.
Yes, that's what my company did.
Yes.
Yeah, we did it, and then we go in. Right. I go in every week, and I spray his house for the roaches. And my assistant actually went in and painted his walls and stuff. But the issue that I'm having right now is I can see holes where I can see outside his house. So when I call code enforcement, I found out there is none for the county. There's no codes for the county for housing. So I'm running around trying to find out how I can get help with this gentleman. Because, and then when we looked, we found out the structure doesn't even exist.
Oh, well, the structure is not even recorded in the county.
No, it's not.
Okay. So it's
so I'm running into a lot of issues. So, I mean, we're running around trying to find resources. And there are some other people that's trying to help me, like sit on the county. You know, they are trying to tell me where to go to find the resources. But I should be documenting all of this. That's what
yes, definitely. Anything that okay. you're doing, you document it because you never know what's going to happen. And I thought you said rodents, R-O-D-E-N-T-S, but you said roaches. So that's why.
He had rodents too.
Okay. That's why I said it may bite the client.
Right.
So roaches may bite.
He had everything.
I don't know.
Yeah, spiders, roaches, ants. I've never seen so many things live together in one place. Yeah. Well, this place actually looks better now. Looks a lot better. We did a lot of work.
Well, good. Just do the best you can. And I know you all go outside and do things that you don't have to do. But that's where the blessing comes in. That's my two cents.
That's mine too.
Anybody else about the assessment?
I have a question.
Off topic.
Hold on, Nicole. I think Frank has one more question. Hold on, Nicole. Go ahead, Frank.
Would a hospital admission necessitate a reassessment?
It can. And now, at one time, they told us if you could talk to the discharge planner when they discharged them and you found out kind of what their status was going home, you may not need to go back out there, but that's hard to do. So when they come, they've been in the hospital, especially for a week or two, sometimes they go overnight and you may just call them and say, what did they do for you or whatever. But if they've been in the hospital for a while or in rehab, you certainly ought to do a reassessment. And a lot of them, if they've been in the hospital, they have a discharge paper. Now, Lord, it's hard for them to find it. It's all bound up in that little pink pail and all of that. Y'all know what I'm talking about. And I would say, where is it? They're like, and you could find it. Or you just ask them kind of what did they do for them or whatever. But if they've been gone, I would say for more than 5 days in the hospital, because that's a long time now, you probably ought to go visit that client and rewrite their care plan or see if it needs to be rewritten. It could just be a supervisory visit, because it may not be that much that changed. So that's up to the judgment of your nurse.
Thank you.
Okay, Nicole?
Yes, so I just have a quick question. So just say two people in the home, one is getting service and the other one does qualify for service as well.
We just lost her right in the middle of that. Maybe she'll come back. Okay, Crystal, you go ahead.
I have a question about the signatures on the care logs. And I think it's probably more of a process question with the system I'm using. And so, Frank, I'm curious what you're doing, because I know you use ClearCare too. But there's times where, and I know you can use, so anybody who uses ClearCare, you can clock out in the ClearCare system or you can call telephony. But you guys probably all had the same problem this past week of caregivers not being able to clock in. There was some like system-wide problem. But we had caregivers still completing their tasks in there, and then they'd go to clock out and they weren't able to clock out, which meant they couldn't sign their care logs, but then they're not going to call telephony and repeat all of those tasks again. So we have these care logs that are unsigned. And I'm curious, I did put in a feature request. So anybody else who uses ClearCare, please put in a ticket and see. What I'm trying to get is a way to be able to send the care log to the caregiver after they've clocked out and we've reviewed the tasks for them to be able to sign it. But do you think that we'd be, if we had something signed upon hire, like a signature saying like you, that they authorize us to upload a copy of their signature to a care log in the event that, you know, our electronic system isn't working, for those times when we, that happens, do you think that the state would accept an uploaded like generic signature if we've made a note saying verified tasks and all of that and then upload the signature to the care log?
They probably would, but it's an exceptional situation. So I would say if the system isn't bugging you about them not being signed, you probably could just make a note in the client's chart or wherever you need to make it to say that the system was having problems from this date to that date. Just make sure that it doesn't look like you overlooked it, that it was something you tried to do and it didn't happen. But that sounds like a great idea, you know, for the A's, because they put the task in, they just couldn't sign off, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. That sounds like a great idea for them to say, you know, for you to say you entered your task, but you weren't able to complete the signature. So we will verify that for you in the event that that happens.
Okay.
Yeah, that might be a great idea and get them to sign off.
And I don't think you actually have to have the signature. I think that's an optional feature kind of really for our protection and mostly for the client. So if we came back for billing and they said, why did we didn't do this or whatever, because at least I know with the old EMRs, is the doctors don't sign off on every single one of their things. What happens is when they put that, you know, it has a, they have a user ID and a password and a time designation stamp. So when they submit that, they can see that, you know, that time went in. I mean, they completed that task when they submitted that documentation.
So you're saying an electronic signature, and I agree with that. That probably would suffice. It's okay. An electronic signature.
The regs state the care log has to be signed by the caregiver. But if I think
that's designed for a paper form, not an electronic form. Somebody put in the chat that it has to be signed if they have long-term care insurance. We haven't found that. We've gotten, all of our clients have gotten reimbursed and a number of our clients, we don't have actual.
So as far as you're aware, the state is not going to look for physical, like signature. They're not going to look for signatures on each care log.
They do look for that on paper care logs. I'm not sure how they handle electronic. Has anyone had an audit with electronic records that they can tell us how it was handled?
I don't want to go on the record
to say, because most of that stuff is related to when everybody was doing paper. That may be something that someone needs to clarify.
Yeah, I know with EMR for healthcare, they do not, you know, have to do that. And so I would assume it would be the same, but you know what they say about assuming.
All right. Thanks, guys.
We can actually check with ClearCare. They probably have a paper on it.
And hopefully they'll fix that little bug there.
Yeah,
it's such a great audit point.
They released an update on 7.5 to the ClearCare app. So if you haven't let your caregivers know already, they can update their ClearCare app. And it seems to be fixed now, but it does happen from time to time. Like, it doesn't always pick up their location. And so anyway.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's a good point. Any other questions anyone has today? I would just like to say, make sure that you're updating that client's chart, that you're not just putting it together the first time and you're not going back in indicating all the stuff you're doing, you know, whether you are doing things for the client to help them, you know, physically around the house or whatever, make sure you're putting that stuff in the chart, because you never know when something happens and there is a complaint You want to show what you were doing, that everything your agency did, you were being responsible, and that you did everything you could to make sure that client had the best care. Any other questions? Well, that's basically what I had for you all today, and I hope that you all have a great weekend, and I'll get in touch with you all next month when we're ready to do our next session. And in the meantime, you all know how to get in touch with me. I will edit and post this video on our YouTube page, and I think most of you know how to find that, but we will be in touch with you all. I see Nicole is back, but I'll just talk to her offline later. All right. Good afternoon, you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ferry.
Bye.
Thank you.